Glad to introduce the next speaker. It's going to be Jeremy. So Jeremy is here. Okay, so Jeremy Yuille. And the topic is going to be on design thinking and design mindset. And it's a pleasure to kind of introduce Jeremy today, because he can almost kind of brings in 20 plus years of experience in design. And his prime focus is going to be on human interaction and user experience. And he's currently the principal at Mel Studio Australia. And he's a strategic thinker, and kind of he loves kind of to express his ideas visually. And on behalf of the team, we'd just like to welcome Yuille on stage, please.
Hello, how are you? Far out, it's really bright up here. Okay, I'm gonna talk about this. My name's Jeremy Yuille. I'm from Sydney. I'm a bit tired. I've just started a Melbourne studio with Meld. This is if you want to tweet about the talk and let all my colleagues know that we're doing some cool stuff. Here are my colleagues. I'm so lucky to work with these people. And I want to talk about this for a second. Okay, so we've heard this talked a little bit, quite a lot today. I really loved how Bapu started today talking about design aptitude, yeah? And so it's kind of interesting to start to hear these things, because this is a while ago that he was talking about that. Design thinking's made a big influence on all of the things that we do. I mean, if we just think about some of the things we've heard about today, think about the changes that have happened. We're talking about bots, we're talking about AI, we're talking about, you know, natural user interfaces, we're talking about all of these things. And, you know, 10, 15 years ago, this stuff really wasn't happening at all. Okay? And a lot of the reason why this is happening now, and a lot of the reason why it's happening so seamlessly, is because of design thinking. So design thinking's done a great deal of good for our industry. It's also got some challenges ahead of it, right? Okay, it becomes commodified, it becomes this kind of set of things that you can do to other people. And so what I want to start to think about in this talk is what happens when we start to work in these kind of complex situations. So this is often a way we talk about the work that we do. I've got to be careful I don't step off the edge. Let's think about all of the things that are going on inside this picture. Okay, all of the computer systems, yes, okay, there's a bunch of digital stuff, you know, there's some screens in the background there that are showing where you're going, there's, you know, the check-in that I had to do beforehand, there's the stuff that's, you know, the person behind the thing that you can never see because it's secret, right, probably because it's so horrible. If you've ever, anyone seen those interfaces? They're atrocious, they're horrible. But then let's think about all of the other things that are happening here as well, okay, so, you know, who designed that counter to be like that? You know, who designed the bag that the person's carrying? Who designed the uniform? Yeah? Who designed the script that the person checking you in uses? Okay, and often what you'll find is that the answer to those things are multiple people who didn't talk with one another. Okay, and so, for instance, no one really owns these kinds of touch points. So I'm very lucky that with Meld, the kinds of work that we do tend to think about design in this way. The company was founded pretty much on the idea that there's a whole lot of stuff that gets left out if we think about digital only. Okay, and this tends to be things like organizational design, strategy, things that really impact the world that we live in. So if we think about design thinking and what it's going to do for this, and we can start to think about, you know, I'd like us to shift our mindset to start to think about design mindset. Okay, this is going to be a theme, I think, running through this conference already. We've had some great conversations with people around this. I've been hearing it underneath a lot of the conversations or a lot of the presentations as well. One of the reasons why I wanted to talk about mindset is that it's not about things that you do to other people. It's about an attitude that you have towards the stuff that you do. Okay? So let's begin. What I'm going to do is talk about four different kind of mindset shifts. This is by no means a theory of everything. This is just some thoughts that I'd like to throw into the ether, into the community, to maybe start a conversation. Let's skip that one. We'll talk about that one tomorrow, actually, in the journey mapping workshop. When we work, is there a laser on this? Whoa. It's not working. When we work, we tend to break things down into these sorts of phases of understanding a situation, exploring it with our clients and people who use it, articulating that situation or articulating the kinds of changes, and then thinking about realizing it. These circles are bigger at this end for a reason. We tend to spend a lot more time up there. And it's in that mindset that I want to talk about some of our projects. The first mindset that I'd like you to start to think about is an embracing of ambiguity. Okay. I was really pleased to hear about the government and designing for government and designing for things like traffic. And my God, 500 million new internet users in this country alone, 80 million houses getting fiber. I live in a country that has 26 million people. So that's kind of interesting to hear that sort of stuff. It blows my mind. This is what it looks like if you try to go to a government one-stop shop center in Australia, okay? The queues are probably a bit shorter than they are here, but nevertheless, there are queues, okay? And there are people who are not having a good time, okay? A lot of our services have been digitized, and there's a huge push to digitize a lot of our services. Yet, the platforms that they were built on and all of those sorts of things are a bit challenged, okay? So this is the reason, or one of the reasons why all those people are in that queue is because they can't do the stuff they want to do online, and the government wants to know something about it. So we've been working with them around that and embracing that ambiguity of this situation, okay? Because this is not just a technical problem, okay? The problem is also around this person here in the blue shirt who works for this center and what they need to do and connecting their experience in with that of the people who are coming to do something, okay? The complexity of these situations when you start to look at population-wide change or technology that's going to work for everyone, and I have no sense of what it's going to be like for some of you to do that here, okay? But what an amazing opportunity, you know? If you think about 500 million new internet users, and you know, it's not going to be about selling them more sand shoes, you know, or more mobile devices. Some of these things that help people to live lives, help people's lives get better, can be delivered through these channels. Okay, so helping people to understand those mental models, making sense of this complexity, this is a mindset that is, you know, well, this is supported by this mindset of embracing ambiguity. It's something that we do. It's something that's very hard to describe. That's one thing I'd like to think about. So this kind of resonates, I suppose, or one thought around this is that if we think about the marketing budgets that were mentioned earlier, right? Okay. And if we think about 20th century design as being about helping the marketing budgets and making people want stuff, yeah? Then 21st century design can be a flip on that to start to think about, well, let's make stuff people want. It's cute, I know, sorry. Oops. Okay, next mindset. Chella, I'm gonna rush through these because we're gonna get to the end soon. Shifting the frame. This is the key thing I think all of us do, okay? It's a key play in the way designers work. And it's a mindset that can be very difficult to embrace if you don't feel as though you have the power, okay? So it's also something that needs lots and lots of practice to help. I'll talk about this with a digital project, okay? Which began as a digital project. We were working with a peak body in Australia. They're kind of involved in keeping all of the standards for how teachers are accredited. So they develop these standards. This weird sort of quasi-government organisation with one shareholder who's the federal minister for education. Okay, so there's a lot of kind of politics and bureaucracy internal to this organisation. We were asked to come in and help a web design firm. Okay, we don't do digital, we don't do production, we don't create these artifacts, but we came in to help them shape and frame this project. Okay, standard sort of stuff, working with teachers, okay, helping them to bring their vision to life, helping them to show us all of the innovation that they're already doing, working with staff, admin staff inside this organization to help them understand what it might be like to inhabit that experience of being a teacher. Okay, so this is a classic empathy map exercise that's going on with people who are really, their job in this organization is to answer the phones and make sure that the, you know, stationery doesn't run out and make sure everyone's supported. Yet, they had value there because, in fact, they're the people who are in contact with the front lines every day. Also working in a super sort of flexible way. So a lot of the artifacts that we use are journey maps. Heard of journey maps? Yeah. We're doing a workshop tomorrow. If you're interested in that, come along. This is a proto journey map in the background here. I believe this is the current state. So we kind of often work with a current state. This is what's going on now. And a future state. This is where we're going to be. This is what you want to do. Being able to move things around like this, this office as well, or the studio where we're working in here, is co-located inside the organization. We're like smack bang in the middle of the place. The two gentlemen on the right, there, are the CIO and his second in command, helping us work through some of the sense making. Okay? So, this is what our final journey map looks like. And it comes all the way along here, you know, and at some point we get to the actual website. So let's just remember, our job to begin with this, and the reason why we're in the room to begin with, is to help them redesign the website, okay? Turns out that, in fact, to redesign the website, there's a whole bunch of stuff that needs to happen back upstream inside the organization. And they didn't realize this, or we kind of helped them to surface this, okay? They knew something needed to be happening up there. They knew that there was a whole lot of stuff already happening that needed to be codified and sort of would end up being rendered into that website. Yet, they had no way of articulating this into the organization, okay? So this is something that we used there as well. And of course, that then leads into thinking about principles that can then be used inside user stories and et cetera, and that's kind of sort of familiar territory, right? Okay, but this ability to be able to shift that frame and say, well, yes, it's about this website, but it's also about the way the organization runs, is a key mindset for designers. In fact, it's kind of like a Trojan horse, right? Familiar with this term or the way that this is used, where you might come in for something digital, but in fact, you know, it's really about, for instance, you know, CRM's a classic one, you know, it's about our conversation with our customers, or, you know, an intranet is about our conversation with our staff. Yeah. So, kind of quote I'd like to use here, and picking up on Dan Hill's work as well from the Trojan Horse, is that Cedric Price's quote here, okay? So if technology is the answer, let's be very, very clear, or at least, you know, critical about what sort of questions are we answering with our technology. Okay, let's shift that frame. Let's use it to explore other ways or other things or other kinds of impact that may be better. Okay, Dan's work is exceptional. I think he's just moving it all to Medium as well. So if you have a look at him, there on Twitter and Medium, you'll find a lot of his old work, and it's amazing, particularly around cities. Okay. Okay, engage deeply. Third mindset. We have this kind of saying at Meld that every project has two projects. Okay. There's the first project, which is around, well, let's actually deliver the impact or the outcome that we said you were going to deliver and that you're paying us for. Yeah. Second project is, well, let's make sure that that doesn't get put on a shelf somewhere. Let's make sure that it has a life inside the organization. Okay. And in order to do that, we found the best way to do that is to engage deeply with our clients. Okay. Design with our clients. This story is about the State Library of Victoria. This is a project we won an award for last year. It's interesting. I mean, if we look at the State Library, this was their organizational structure. Okay. It's also this beautiful reading room internally. But it's this 19th century command and control panopticon kind of, you know, way of thinking about an organization and its relationship with its customers, which has totally changed. It's almost come back full circle to what libraries used to be for, you know, which is places of creation rather than consumption. Okay, so we worked with them for quite a while, and the key thing here is that our second meeting at that library was with their union. Okay, because if any changes are going to happen, it's a highly unionized workforce. I'm not sure what that's like here in India, but in Australia, the trained unions in particular with libraries and this library, there's a strong tradition there, and there's a strong kind of, that's one of the forces that we needed to work with, we needed to have on board, and we needed to make sure, because any changes that are going to come out of this design process are going to have to be able to be done. You know, this is the feasibility thing. It's not technology, it's, you know, legislation, culture. Okay. Again, we set up on site. I want you to keep an eye on this guy, okay? He's our client. We're actually, he's someone from the library who came and camped in with us for the project, for the entire project, okay? And again, this is us working with a current state map. So there's a lot of construction going on here. There's a lot of kind of co-creation going on here. People's voices are being put into the mix, okay? People's, you know, notes, people's scribbles, they're all part of this, okay? This is tough to do, this kind of engagement, but it is very worth it. It's totally worth it because it's kind of like investing at the beginning of a project. A lot of then the changes later on down the track just fall out of this trust and kind of co-creation that's been created. This is the group working, I think it's like 8:30 in the morning. It's, you know, hour and a half before the patrons can come into the library, setting up, physically prototyping some things. You know, so again, you can see our friend standing just here. And this is us kind of pinning up work in progress inside the halls of the library where a lot of the work kind of gets critiqued, a lot of decisions get made, and he doesn't look like a client anymore. This is what I love about this photo, okay? Inside this picture, there's no one from our company here. And so this is kind of one of the litmus tests, I suppose, of thinking about how would we, what's success or what's the kind of impact that we'd like to create in this kind of project if we're working deeply engaging, it's that we can walk away and there are champions inside this organization who can continue to advocate for this. Okay. There's our final future state map. It had a great deal of impact. I mean, it was used as part of an application to the state government for $80 million of funding to refurbish the library. It's like 4 billion rupee, I think. Excuse me. Everyone can see their fingerprints in this, okay? Because they're there. because they've been engaged along the way. It means that a lot of these decisions about, well, what are we going to do next? And is this the direction that we're going in? Have already happened. So the change happens not just at, you know, in the unit that hired us, it happened throughout the entire organization. Often when we redesign these sorts of things, change has to happen inside the organization as a result of that. Engaging people, deeply engaging people inside the design process helps to set the ground, or nemawashi, you know, this Japanese term for preparing the ground, creating it sort of arable so that, you know, the flowers can bloom. Okay, so this is something I'd like you to take away from that in terms of engagement. Excellent. Okay, last one. Building capability. Just have a look at this list, okay? This is a list of outcomes some people wanted at the end of a workshop with us. We find ourselves doing this more and more. This is this idea that instead of us coming in and doing the job for someone, we will come in and help them to get better at doing this. Okay, so this is the idea of building capability. It's inside every kind of project, and it's kind of at that core of design being a constructive act. Yeah, very similar to education in some ways. This is with the Australian Tax Office, that list of things. Okay, so they're fairly similar kind of problems that you'd find with any design department inside a large technical organization. This is the organization that does all of our income tax and all of those sorts of taxes. Okay, it's pretty important for Australia. They've been a huge investor in design over the years. And we worked with them to help all of their designers get better at understanding this service design kind of language and skill set. Okay, they were happy. This is with the Museum of Victoria as well. And the key thing here, I think, that's really interesting is that we not only have designers, but see the suits over in the corner here as well? Okay, all the executive came in. And there's a thing here around sort of when you build capability, so you know, as the previous speaker was talking about, you need it coming from the top as much as you do from the bottom, okay? And you need this mandate from leadership. So what better way but to help them speak the speak? There we are, okay. So this is what I was taught as a kid. It's kind of what I think about in terms of building capability. When we do a project with people, let's leave them in a better state to be able to continue doing the work. A key thing here and a secret, I suppose, is that then you get to do better work with them later on. It goes further up the value chain rather than doing the same job again. Okay, so here we are, you know. Four mindsets, four ways of thinking about an attitude towards design that's not about, you know, taking someone through a process, but it's about taking yourself through a process. So that is the one more thing, sorry. It's that you actually have this responsibility, I suppose, to yourself to use design to start to think about how are you going to change your attitude towards what it is that you do, trying to make impact. Okay, now I did want to add two more things at the end of this. All this talk about education, okay? There is a free MOOC that's going on right at the moment, started this week. You can sign up for it, doesn't cost a cent. That's running based on some work. So previous to with Meld, I was 15 years inside tertiary education. And the work we did there around designing a program for this kind of 21st century design skill is now being, you know, part of that's been carved off and taken into this FutureLearn MOOC. So I'd really recommend checking it out. You can still join that. There's some great stuff in there around service design, around transition design, which I think is a fantastic kind of thing that you're going to really, it's going to be very useful for those 500 million people, you know. This is, again, sorry. It leads into a master's that we developed at RMIT called the Master of Design Futures, okay? So that's a couple of other things just at the end of there. Wrap it up because now I'm at the end. Thank you very much.